Arthur Ransome is remembered for many things. He gave us that delightful book, Swallows and Amazons, that brightened our childhoods. He was a journalist, a foreign correspondent, a reporter of the Russian Revolution. He was a friend of Lenin, Litvinov. His travels over half a century took him from the Baltic to Cairo, from Cairo to China. But the trips that he wrote about with the greatest pleasure were those he made in England and Scotland with his rod and line. He was, you see, also a learned, practiced, and witty fisherman. And he called his book simply Rod and Line. A fisherman myself and a devotee of Arthur Ransome, I'm setting out with my rod and line to try and savor a little of Ransome's inspiration. From now on, the words that you'll hear will be his, except now and then in moments of excitement when I may have to interrupt him. Then you'll hear mine. Frank resumption of Paleolithic life without the spur of Paleolithic hunger is how fishing was recently described in a learned book on human nature, and it was not meant as praise. Fishermen need question only the tone in which the words are used, for the actual words offer a profounder justification of fishing than is offered by most professed apologists. What they don't mean is a resumption of Stone Age barbarity. This age of flying machines, big guns, poison gas, cheap newspapers, and other means of creating and justifying hate and panic has only recently given proof of barbarity on such a scale as has never been equaled in this history of man.
We have no need to return to the Stone Age to look for barbarity. We have enough and to spare.
But it is true that fishing allows us to refresh ourselves by a temporary resumption of a life in which a man's chief concern is not inextricably confounded with other men's activities, but is simply to trick a dinner out of the river. The packet of sandwiches in his pocket, his possible dislike of eating fish, does not affect this matter in the least. We have no need for the spur of Paleolithic hunger. Our fishing satisfies quite another need.
Oh, dear.
Escaping to the Stone Age by the morning train from Manchester, the fisherman engages in an activity that allows him to shed the centuries as a dog shakes off water and allows him to recapture not only his own youth, but the youth of the world. He may not know that this is his aim. Indeed, if he were too conscious of it, he'd not be able to achieve it.
But if we watch him, we notice a number of signs that show clearly enough that when he goes fishing, his primary reason is not the need of fish.
Lovely. Dead right. The bug is not going to take. I'm afraid. Ah! Couldn't be better. Deserves fish.
He imposes on himself unwritten laws that betray his real intention. He is not moved by a primitive instinct for slaughter. If he were, he could satisfy it better by using a hand grenade, poison, or a net. Unwritten laws give the fish approximately the same chance that they had against the hungry savage.
Oh, it deserves a fish. That deserves a fish. But there's not one obliging, I'm afraid.
The fisherman sets the highest value on those fish which have made the highest demand on his personal prowess, his knowledge of nature, his watercraft, and his skill.
I'm afraid might be one up there.
Because that catch would best satisfy the fisherman's instinctive desire to match himself alone in his voluntary contest with nature.
Yeah, good.
There is no hostility in this contest. The trout chasing minnows or picking flies from the surface of the stream is contesting with nature in the same way as the fisherman chasing trout. Neither trout nor fishermen are opposed to nature in their several activities. Quite the contrary.
No, I'm afraid.
We return in fishing, not to the stone, but to the golden age. What we are doing is to exchange an elaborate and indirect for a simple and direct relationship with nature.
To move up the stream.
That doesn't mean that fishing is simply a means of escape from our over-elaborate life, for it is enjoyed by men who have lived all their lives on the riverbank, as well as by those who escaped their fishing from the towns. The truth, I think, is that we resume Paleolithic life, not because of preference for any past age, but to seek a relationship with nature which is valuable in all ages.
Never know.
The good fisherman is always engaged in the active use of his imagination. He is the fish he catches. He, as that fish, feels the currents in the pool and pushes his way to shelter in a pocket of still water. The fish that go into his creel are so many testimonials to his right reading of nature. The power of vision that he develops while fishing persists when the rod is in its case.
The fisherman knows what's happening in the river when he's not there. When the rain beats down on the autumn streets. He's conscious as he buttons up his coat about his neck of the fish running up the Eden and the Solway Firth. The pavements of green grass under his feet. Stone walls of the houses are no prison to him. Through the roar of the towns, he hears running water.
It is this vision that distinguishes fishing from such pursuits as golf, cricket, football, billiards, or chess. These games do not affect a man's relationship to nature. Fishing does.
No. I got a fish. Damn.
In looking around for another pursuit, which also affects man's relationship with nature, I think of gardening. The gardener, like the fisherman, resumes a Paleolithic life without the spur of Paleolithic hunger.
There we are, then. Up, 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 up.
It is true as well that, like the fisherman, the gardener becomes so much a part of nature that he is reconciled to the changes of the year. He welcomes the seasons as they come and no longer wishes to put a spoke in the wheel of time.
Well, there's the supper. Generally said that gardeners and fishermen make fine old men. Well, that's not surprising. They have been caught up into nature. Grow old with the goodwill, no hanging back, and are without misgivings about their own mortality. Well, yes. Try another flower. Something will change.